Thank you very much. So hello everyone, welcome back. In titling this session, Modernism's Corpses, Alain and I were struck by the fact that the proposals that we received, many dealt with this kind of confluence between practices in the 1960s and 1970s at, let's say, the purported death or destruction of modernism, and the prominent position of body in those practices, a body in a sense that was no less under attack than modernism itself. If such work was charged by the particular political, ecological, and sexual dynamics of that historical moment, these papers that we selected also seemed attentive to the significance of those dynamics today, rediscovered and reimagined according to the vicissitudes of violence and destruction in our own time. I'm pleased to introduce our first speaker, Oliver Schultz. Oliver is a doctoral candidate and Hume Fellow in the Arts at Stanford University, where he specialises in the history and theory of modern and contemporary art, with a focus on radical aesthetic practices in post-1960s Europe and the United States. His work focuses on philosophical questions of materiality, embodiment, and intimacy. In 2013-14, he served as Fisher Curatorial Fellow at SFMOMA, and is currently writing his dissertation on the work of Paul Tech. Oliver's paper is entitled Queer Disfiguration, Paul Tech and the Corpus of American Art, circa 1967.
These sculptures, made between 1964 and 1967, brought Tech substantial success in the New York art world at the moment. Among them were objects like Warrior's Leg of 66-67, which presented mutilated, dismembered, or otherwise destroyed bodies, or more often parts of bodies, in meticulously shaped and polychromed beeswax. Rendered with the verisimilitude of Trombloet, Tech placed his realistic depictions of flesh inside transparent viewing chambers that resembled vitrines. At first, the vitrines contained only amorphous hunks or slabs of flesh, sometimes apparently human and bearing actual human hair, as in Untitled from 64, and at other times explicitly animal, as in Hippopotamus from the following year. Though the particular figuration of each of Tech's meat pieces was unique, all were encased inside these rectilinear enclosures that often evoked nothing so much as works by Larry Bell or Donald Judd, and that was a very intentional evocation. By 1966, however, the meat pieces had taken on such recognizable human anatomies as arms, legs, fingers, and faces. These later objects were often based upon casts of the artist's own body. This was still not a whole body, however, but one radically dismembered and often carefully enshrined inside containers that both screened, always carefully enshrined inside containers that both screened the viewer from their abject violence and ensured their uncanny preservation, or at least the rather rhetoric thereof. If this disfigured flesh seemed all but real, it was nevertheless absent decay, kept perpetually pristine inside its geometric housing. The undecayed status of the flesh in a work like Warrior's Leg returns us to Tech's trip to Italy, 3 years before its making. In particular, it brings us to a photograph of the artist taken on that trip, a photograph which is both a striking portrait and an important document of that revelation which occasioned both Tech's turn to sculpture in general and to the figuration of flesh in particular. the many remarkable portraits that Peter Ujar videotheque, this is perhaps the most significant. In it, we see the handsome young artist facing us with a cool self-awareness. He addresses the camera, or indeed the photographer, with a playful, suggestive regard. The image is arresting, not just for the portrait at its center, but even more for its setting, the catacombs of Palermo's Capuchin Monastery, where the mummified bodies of deceased friars line the walls, providing an uncanny contrast with Tech's lively form. 3 years later, in an interview with the critic Gene Swenson, Tech was asked what had inspired his meat pieces. In response, he referred to precisely the experience documented in this photograph. He told Swenson that he hoped his meat would convey some semblance of what it was like to be in that Capuchin crypt, surrounded by so many corpses, to not just see, but also touch them. I'll give you the text of this quote. "The initial feeling," he said, "is so stunning, you fall back for a moment, and then it's exhilarating. There are 8,000 corpses, not skeletons, corpses, decorating the walls, and the corridors are filled with windowed coffins. I opened one and picked up what I thought was a piece of paper. It was a piece of dried thigh. I felt strangely relieved and free. It delighted me that bodies could be used to decorate a room like flowers. We accept our thingness intellectually, but the emotional acceptance of it can be a joy." The Tech wanted to convey a similar sense of delight in the haptic quality of his meat points to the degree to which pleasure is at stake in his work of the period. For Tech, feeling always came before form. As Richard Meyer and Catherine Ward have suggested, there is a deep eroticism to the thinness of Tech's hunks of meat, one that they explicitly understand as queer, and that's their term. As Hujar's portrait of his lover in the Palermo catacombs makes clear, that eroticism was very much present from the beginning in Tech's relation to the deathly body. We have only to return to Hujar's portrait to confirm this. Look again at the limp corpses that populate the image and how they contrast with Tech's form. If the mummies appear to be precariously holding their own against gravity, their decay slowly giving way to the sap of time, then Tech's body is not just alive, but taut, muscled, and flushed, and robust. The anatomy of his arms seems almost to bulge from the surface of the image, so much the more when juxtaposed against his collapsed and shrouded counterparts. The deep tonal contrasts dramatically highlight those supine bodies, making them glow in the burned-out blackness of their chambers, half coffin and half vitrine. The photographic chiaroscuro is especially dramatic in the passage between Tech's right leg and the negative space of the coffins, where blackness sweeps the contour of the painter's legs before plunging again into what we might read as a punctum, the deep shadow at the center of his crotch. In 1976, Hujar published the other photographs taken on the Palermo trip in his book, Portraits in Life and Death, so 13 years after they were taken. In her introduction to that book, Susan Sontag wrote, quote, "Photography converts the whole world into a cemetery," end quote. In the mise en abyme of Hujar's photo, a literal cemetery is reflected in and as another form of deathly space, that of the photograph itself. Recalling Roland Barthes' understanding of the photograph, Hujar's photo is also an intimate space, a space of desire, longing, and interiority. If the crypt image is one laced with desire, then we might say Tech's experience of the bodies in the Capuchin catacombs was similarly charged. What Hujar's portrait finally indexes, I think, is the eruption of a modality of desire fundamental to the aesthetics of Tech's meat pieces. Not just the queer desire between photographer and subject, or viewer and object, but an even queerer desire for a tactile relation to materiality as such, or the feel of its flesh and the texture of its impermanence. Interestingly, Hujar's Palermo portrait does not appear in the 1976 book. It was instead discovered and printed a decade after his death, in 1994. In that image, what Sontag calls in her introduction the quote-unquote sex appeal of death is overdetermined by the libidinal charge of Tech's self-embracing arms, his cocked hips, and his penetrating gaze. If, as Elizabeth Sussman suggests, this crypt picture of 1963 was, quote, essential to the next phase of Tech's work, end quote, and perhaps it was just as crucial for Hujar. Too intimate to be suitable for publication, it was something Hujar had to keep to himself, just as Bart in Camera Lucida ever shows us the Wintergarten photograph. Tech and Hujar remained romantic partners throughout the 1960s, a period in which Tech's carefully crafted meat sculptures garnered him praise and infamy alike. From 64 to 66, he showed his sculptures at New York's Stable Gallery and at Pace, alongside figures like Oldenburg, Rosenquist, and Warhol, who became a perhaps unwitting collaborator. The same year that Warrior's Leg was begun, the young artist and critic Robert Smithson wrote that Tech had, quote, achieved a putrid finesse, end quote, what he called a hyper-opulence that he opposed to a group of now canonical minimalists that included Morris, Flavin, LeWitt, and Judd. Yet Tech's meteoric rise to fame was matched only by the totality of his eclipse from the dominant narratives of American art. Unlike that of Morris, Flavin, LeWitt, and Judd, Tech's work has had little place in the stories we tell about American art in the past half century. Although arguably a symptom of what Hal Foster once identified as a larger return to the real in the art of the 60s, the superrealism of Tech's destroyed bodies was in many ways all too real, too charged with affect. If the viscerality of Tech's putrid finesse gained him acclaim in the sensationalist art world of the New York art world of the 60s, it also helped banish his work to the margins of a later discourse increasingly suspicious of spectacle as an agent of domination. Although every bit as interested in phenomenology as were Smithson's canon of minimalists, Tech's objects were not at all concerned with phenomenal experience as an abstraction, not so much sculptural actualizations of what might otherwise be articulated as theory. They instead aimed to implicate the viewer in that feeling that Maurice Merleau-Ponty once called enfleshment, offering up to vision what it was when the self felt itself as flesh. For Tech, the seeing of flesh engendered that kind of bodily empathy that animates Merleau-Ponty's conception of the entangled relation between body and world. "I become involved with things with my body," writes Merleau-Ponty. "They coexist with me as an incarnate subject." In an era when the subject was being increasingly emptied out of art, Tech thus embraced and investigated the material presence of the self through the decidedly outmoded idiom of figurative wax sculpture. In this way, Tech was very much an art of subject formation, an art that both figured and disfigured selfhood. This makes it especially curious that despite a renewed interest in Tech, especially over the last few years, little attention has been paid to the nature of his own selfhood. Tech was, after all, decidedly queer. As we have seen, his intimacy with Hujar in the 1960s, as well as with other men in later years, was often at the center of his practice. As Meyer and Lord, among others, have suggested, there's the queer materiality of his reliquaries exerting their uncanny erotics of repulsion and attraction. But what the crypt picture reminds us is that this queerness also had to do with temporality, the temporality of Tech's undecaying flesh, its saint-like, but also Frankensteinian incorruptibility. The queer theorist Elizabeth Freeman, in her brilliant exegesis on Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, has argued that, quote, "Frankenstein's monster is a body that contains a history of bodies and of bodiliness, and thus figures a gender and a sexuality that themselves write a history of genders and sexualities," unquote. Tech's dismembered yet undecaying figurations are similarly monstrous and similarly laced with historicity, not just in that they seem to present long dead, hacked off yet unspoiled, but also insofar as they are given the title of reliquaries, which although it was given to the works later on, I think it's a very important title, because reliquaries, after all, present an outmoded notion of the body as a conduit between the realms of the sacred and the profane. In rejuvenating the notion of the reliquary in the context of 60s American art, Tech was imbuing his destroyed bodies with precisely Freeman's notion of a history of bodies and of bodiliness, one that not only figured sexuality, but disfigured it. Perhaps Perhaps what was most queer about Keck's non-belonging in time was his fascination with its own mortality, a fascination that in 1967 produced what is widely considered to be his magnum opus, his first environmental sculpture, The Tomb. At the center of this work was a life-size wax effigy of the artist, a corpse cast directly from his own body, dressed in a blazer and jeans, and laid to rest inside a small wooden ziggurat painted a flesh-like shade of pink that echoed the skin color of the figure. The fingers on the right hand of Tech's corpse had been severed and placed in a small pouch that hung from the interior wall. It's not quite visible here, but you'll see it in the later work. While small, circular discs of wax painted in psychedelic floral colors had been affixed to the figure's cheeks. Not only a critical and popular sensation, The Tomb also represented an early example of installation art, a total environment that viewers were invited to enter and engage with bodily. This environment consisted not only of the wooden ziggurat, but also what Lindsay Levansky has described as, quote, a mock archaeological display, where casts of body parts that preceded the fabrication of the effigy were placed in cases on the floor and roped off with red cords like fines from a dig, end quote. Tech thus presented himself not only as deceased, but as excavated, a doubly untimely body. Writing in art form that year, the critic Robert Pincus Whitten called The Tomb, quote, a monument which may easily prove to be one of the unanticipated yet representative masterworks of American sculpture of the 60s, end quote. It seems clear that in no small part this reception had to do with what the public read as a hippie corpse. The combination of apparently blown off fingers and psychedelic flowers suggested charged associations in the context of the escalating Vietnam War, as well as offering the fate of a hippie culture increasingly mired in drugs and death. This view was most famously espoused by the artist Mike Kelly, who perhaps more than anyone else was responsible for a posthumous reappraisal of Tech's work in the 1990s, when he argued that the artist's historiography revealed something crucial about American art history's ideological function, one which he saw as spookily aligned with the conservative condemnation of the counterculture of the American 60s. Kelly wrote in 1992, America's problem with Tech mirrors our culture's problem with the 1960s as a whole. To the art world, the 1960s was a glorious, almost classical epoch. Art was cool, reasonable, and in touch with the national identity. The 60s was the last golden age of modernism before the fall orchestrated by postmodernism. Compare this to the tale told by the Reagan-Bush clan. For them, the 1960s was the liberal decade, the out-of-control period, directly responsible for America's economic and social decline. It was a period of dirt, mysticism, drugs, and anarchy, America's dark ages. This is Paul Tech's 1960s, which is why he's so hard to reconcile with the official versions of recent art history now emerging. So that was 1992. For Kelly, the same forces that brought Tech his success in the 60s also condemned him to exile from the corpus of a 60s avant-garde that was being used during this era. And as Kelly writes, the artist's fingers, his, quote, generative organs, had been, quote, chopped off and placed in a bag around the figure's neck like the kill tokens taken by soldiers in Vietnam who fashioned necklaces of human fingers, like the genitals hacked off and stuffed into the mouths of lynched blacks, unquote. The tomb was absent from art history precisely because of a willful amnesia. It represented everything that America had to forget about itself in order to survive, a period whose hauntings would otherwise be unbearable. But perhaps critics of the 60s were as woefully blind to another aspect of Tech's tomb as was Kelly in his motivated reading of the sculpture as a quote-unquote shrine to anti-Americanism. The sense in which Tech's corpse also reiterates the visual rhetoric of the Catholic martyr. Thus, if Tech could be seen as a sculpture radically attuned to the cultural and social context of America in the 60s in his depiction of a dead hippie, he might equally be seen as out of sync with that freewheeling moment in his evocation of a very old and decidedly outmoded aspect of Catholic devotion, Moreover, if Tech's corpse is a self-portrait, another seemingly outmoded genre of art-making in the 60s, then in fact all his meat pieces might be said to be similarly concerned with self-portraiture. And here, I take the notion of self-portrait in a parallel sense to the way that Alexander Nemirov argues that the 19th century still-life painter Raphael Peale's naturalistic renderings of meat could be seen as efforts to render the negation of his own self, as meditations on what it was to be embodied as a self against itself. If, like Peale's uncanny paintings, Tech's meat pieces and his tomb were almost totally absent from the larger corpus of American art proper, then this has as much to do with their problematic relation to the question of subjectivity, and in Tech's case, a persistent reiteration of religiosity, as it does with any social or political commentary we might otherwise read from them. What finally supports the reading of Tech's corpse as more martyr than hippie is the curious afterlife of the tomb. After being exhibited in a host of very prestigious venues in the US and Europe for nearly a decade after it was first exhibited in 1967, actually more than a decade, Tech refused to accept the work when it was finally returned to him in New York in the early 80s. Documents from the Hudson Shipping Company made clear the frustration of the handlers who attempted to deliver Tech's sculpture back to him, only to find that he would not accept it. He claimed it had been damaged, and that he would instead have to be compensated for the value of the artwork. But when no compensation was forthcoming, he still did not accept it, and after that, it disappeared. Its whereabouts are now unknown. Thus, Tech's masterpiece was lost, and today exists solely in the form of the documentary photographs you've been seeing. If martyrdom involves the willful casting away of the body, its negation in favor of something else, something intangible, then it might be said that Tech chose for his corpse the only appropriate fate. Rather than attempt to preserve it, he opted for its destruction. This recalls the self-immolation of Frankenstein's monster, and in an act which, as Freeman writes, quote, suggests how unbearable the weight of a more self-reflexively historical being is in a culture that demotes such ways of knowing. For Freeman, and this is still her quote, Frankenstein's monster is monstrous because he lets history too far in, embodying it instead of merely feeling it, even embodying the historicity of the body revealed when erotic contact with the past produces sensations that are unintelligible by present sexual and gender codes, unquote. At least from the moment of his trip to Palermo, Tech's erotic contact with the past was similarly transgressive, producing works just as alien to the discourses of a later art history. In that way, the fate of Tech's corpse mirrored that of his whole corpus, preserved as fragments but impossible to assimilate as a whole, not just absent from the body of 1960s American art, Tech actively burned himself out of it, and this, perhaps, was his queerest disfiguration of all. Thank you.